Can you hear me? Oh, I just was barely on there. How are you all doing this morning?
Great.
Oh my gosh. Lance, how are you doing this morning? You're doing good too? Good. I'm happy to hear that. I'm Eric. I'm one of the pastors here at Axiom. I just wanted to say welcome. Thank you for being here today. We have a few announcements at the start of things before we get rolling here on worship. We want to remind folks that we are actually in the season of Lent right now. And so what that looks like is our community has been pressing into a series of practices and traditions that the church has historically practiced. And one of those things is we celebrated Fat Tuesday, we celebrated Ash Wednesday, we're going to be celebrating Good Friday coming up here in a few weeks, and we're also regularly now on Wednesday evenings, we're doing a guided prayer session. So if you're interested in participating in the Lenten season, please consider on Wednesday evenings coming by here and participating in guided prayer. I believe it starts at 6 p.m., correct? Yeah, it starts at 6 p.m. So if you're interested in participating in what we do with Lent, please consider showing up here Friday at 6 p.m. Some other stuff that's coming up here this week, iHelp Outreach is happening this Wednesday. Yes, woo! This is happening here this Wednesday. So we need volunteers for that. Basically what it is, if you're asking, what am I volunteering for, Pastor Eric? Well, we actually are housing folks who are experiencing homelessness here in the facility on Wednesdays. So we provide food for them. We provide a place for them to sleep at night. And we provide some relationship and company, just talking with folks, getting to know their story. So I want to encourage you, if you are interested in serving in that way, please sign up in the lobby and plan on being here on Wednesday evening for that. Another thing that's happening this Saturday is Second Saturday. Has anybody ever been to that before here? Oh, yeah. Okay. Woo. Party over there. Mike especially has been here. He is really here. No, it's something. It's a really awesome event that we do every month besides summer because, you know, you can't be outside in the summer. But it's something that we partnered with the city to do out here. It's an arts, music, food, and all sorts of stuff festival. So what we do in our yard, we get a lot of vendors together. We get some bands playing, and we get some food trucks going. And so we just want to encourage everybody at Axiom to attend this and really just be the presence of Christ here in our space and just be that witness and to have a fun time with people and party with them. So that's this Saturday. Make sure that you you mark that on your calendar and show up. Another thing that's happening, it's exactly what it sounds like. It's men's breakfast. It's men having breakfast together. It's going to be the 18th at 9:30 a.m. If you are a man and you would like to eat breakfast with other men here at Axiom, show up here at 9:30 a.m. We're going to be doing it in the Axiom yard. There'll be food and coffee is my understanding. So please make sure you show up for that as well. If you haven't noticed, we do have a lot of stuff going on here at Axiom. In fact, we have more things than I even have just said right now. If you want to learn about those things, we're encouraging everybody to fill out a Connect card, leave us your email address so we can put you on our mailer, because our mailer is really the place where all the events and details about what's going on in the life of Axiom really kind of gets discussed. So if you're interested in learning even more than what we have up here, please go ahead and sign up for our mailer. Now, got that out of the way. We're going to enter into our time of worship, and one of the things that we like to do as part of our worship is we like to pass the peace of Christ to one another. What we're doing during this time is acknowledging that the peace of Jesus Christ resides with each one of us here in this room, and we like to acknowledge that in the other and share that expression with one another. So will you stand with me right now and go around to a few folks you've never met before, shake their hand and say, may the peace of Christ be with you. All right, won't you do that with me? Thanks.
Peace. Well, good morning. Glad you are with us. Just invite you to join us in worship. Really stand with us. We're gonna spend some time together just singing and proclaiming who God is. And just invite us to a space of wasteful worship. Let's pour ourselves out before the one who loves us so much. into this space exactly as we are, as you receive us, Lord, in any condition, whether suffering, sickness, heartache, joy and celebration, all of those things in between. You receive us, Lord, as your desire is just us and our hearts, relationship. Just pray that you would, right now, Lord, just remove anything that might be in the way of us just pouring ourselves out before you. Remove our burdens, our distractions. Let us place them here.
Yeah.
Ourselves out at your feet. We might be willing to waste our time on you, God, as you lavish us with so much. So open our hearts to that this morning. Amen.
Amen. Thank you so much for worshiping with us, you guys. We're going to step into a time of offering, which is just another form of worship. It's a pretty cool chance where you get to just offer anything you have unto God and just trust that He will provide for you and provide for our community and our church body. So there's going to be a couple different ways you can give that pop up on the screen. You can go to our website. We also have an app. You can text. And we also have some kiosks in the back you can utilize, or if you have physical donations you would like to give, there's little boxes in the back for that as well. But I'm going to go ahead and pray for our offering, and then that'll take us into the message. God, thank you so much for allowing us to gather here today and helping us become one within your spirit, God. I pray that you take the offering that is given today and you are able to make your will be done here as it is in heaven. That you are able to unify us as a community and truly touch the heart and lives of those surrounding us in the neighborhoods, and those who may not know you, God. I pray that you're able to just come into their heart and show them your comfort and your peace, God. And as we're stepping into the message, I pray that you open our hearts and our minds to allow our cups to be filled with your Spirit. In your holy name, amen.
Amen. Yes, amen. All right. Greetings, my people. How are you? Good. I'm doing well. Nice to be with you guys. We are talking about talking with God when you pray. And we are in Lent. How's that going, by the way? 11 days in. Spirit is willing, the flesh is weak. No? Yeah, good. Everybody's like, what's Lent? It's okay. We're only in a series on it. So you're in a good place. My guess is when you pray that there might be moments of doubt. Or when you pray, there might be seasons of quiet. Or when you pray, you might sense something is taking place in you. Your confidence might even be going up. When you pray, all sorts of things can happen. And depending on who you're talking to, all sorts of responses you might hear. Prayer can be tricky. And yet, we're a people that pray. And I think we pray because we sense that there's something that we're longing for. And for some of us, that might just be like guidance, right? For others, it might be comfort. For others, like, I don't know what it is, But typically we pray because we are after something. I would be curious, what is that thing that you are after? I also know that when you pray, that sometimes there are boundaries you bump into, barriers that you experience. And finding ourselves between these two things of, here's what I'm longing for, I sense something's out there, and here's what's actually taking place, can be disorienting. It can be. So today I want to talk about the barriers and the burning, the longing and the roadblocks. I want to explore those edges together. You know, 85% of adults pray in this country. 85% pray in this country at least once a month. Prayer actually is quite common. I would venture to say that the percentage is higher than that, the people that have prayed. It's commonplace, and yet we find that we are full of questions about how do I pray? And we're also afraid to pray because it's uncomfortable. It can be awkward. It can be awkward on your own, let alone with others. How many of you, if I was like, all right, I want you to go find somebody in the room you've never hung out with, I want you guys to just pray. And you'd be like, yes. Probably not, right? Maybe a few of you. What is it about that space of prayer that moves it from commonplace, which it is, 85%+ pray, to being uncomfortable? Even with our loved ones. 11% of married couples pray together. 11% of Christian married couples pray together. 100% of married couples fight together. 87% of married couples have intimacy together. What is prayer? Why is that one not on the list? Why is it not as high on the list? Well, I think because it feels too intimate for some. That's what I hear in some form or another. It's too vulnerable. I don't hear that being intimate together is too vulnerable, but I hear that praying together is too vulnerable. When Kendall and I first started dating, I was scared to pray with her. I was. And she was scared to pray with me. And I remember our first prayer together. We just got back from a date and had our first kiss. That's right. We had our first kiss before our first prayer. And then our first prayer was asking for forgiveness right afterwards. But why is it that we were more comfortable smooching lips than we were holding hands and talking to God? It's intimate. And it should be, because it is. It's scary close to what home really is. And that's that burning space. That longing space. And the boundary line between that intimate, scary, close place with God and others is, I don't know, is it confidence? Is it strength? Is it practice? How is it that we hop that wall? And this is why I'm talking about this in Lent, because it turns out that prayer and intimacy relate to this idea of Lent. 1 Corinthians 7:5, Paul says this, "Do not deprive one another sexually, except when you agree for a time to devote yourselves to prayer. Then come together again so that Satan will not tempt you because of your lack of self-control." So notice right here that there is a space of withholding from the flesh, of saying no to starving the flesh and saying yes to the Spirit, even in this place in our marriages. But Lent is not a place that we withhold from prayer. And what I found is that when I meet with couples that are dealing with problems in the bedroom, they are also dealing with problems in the prayer room, and vice versa. Because prayer is intimate. It's relational. We were made for it. Communion with God is what we were made for. And to try to live without knowing it and experiencing it is dangerous. It's why in moments of danger we turn to God, by the way. It's why we pray at all, because we understand at a core level that there's something beyond our grasp. There's a knowing that goes beyond our senses. That's why we pray. Even folks that like don't have a relationship with God or don't know how to put language to who God is or what God is, pray. Because something's happening fundamentally. And that's part of the beauty of prayer. That we entertain what is not seen, what is not touched, what is not felt, what is not always audible, yet it is deeply transformative and deeply tangible. When we pray, we say that the senses are not enough. When we pray, we say that the physical landscape is insufficient for life abundant. When you pray, the act of prayer itself is a skepticism of the flesh. You call into question that that would ever be enough. When we pray, we confess that there's more to life than eating and drinking. And every time you do it, and everywhere you do it, you participate in more, not less. We recognize that the flesh is not enough. It's God is Spirit. And that's why when we pray, every time we pray, everywhere we pray, in some form we join Jesus in what he says and what we looked at last week in Matthew 4, verse 4. Man shall not live on bread alone, but on every word that comes from the mouth of God. When you pray, you are participating in the more. I can't think of a place of more desolation and isolation than the life of no prayer. Think about it. There's nowhere in the world that you could go. You could go somewhere no human being's ever been, and you could pray, and God would be there. But you can go to the busiest intersection or the fullest church and choose not to pray and be in the most lonely space you've ever been. To make a decision without any engagement with God. That's how some of us live. We just have our thoughts. And our second thoughts and third thoughts. And sometimes then we need other people's thoughts. How incapable we are of coming to our own understanding. And that again lies at the heart of the nature of prayer, is this acknowledgement that there is more. That there's a limitation in the flesh and an excess in the spirit. And that's why we pray, "Thy will be done." Because we're looking for direction. The heart is burning for guidance. We sense that we need someone who's been before us. We're still hungry because deep down we know that there's still more. This desire for direction is kind of where I think the bracelets we used to wear emerge, right? The WWJD bracelets. I'm not calling you out if you're rocking one. It's totally cool. But we could think about that here for a moment. What would Jesus do? What if we were to shift that just a little bit? Because the notion that what would Jesus do invites you to think for yourself what he would do. But what if instead you chose to say, "I don't want to think for myself. I'm actually just curious in what he would do. Could he share his desire with you versus you just think about what he did?" That's the place of relationship, isn't it? That's the place of union that we're talking about. Prayer is not thinking about what God wants us to do. Prayer is asking God to reveal to us his desires for you. And here's the key. This is so key. As that happens, when you go to God seeking his desires, seeking what he wants, seeking his direction, as you go to God, sometimes he'll tell you exactly what you're asking for. But most of the time, instead of telling you what you're asking for, he's going to begin to shape in your heart the very desire that he has instead. And that's a major shift. It's a shift from a relationship that he exists to serve our needs whenever they pop up, to an intimate space of unfolding, of getting to know. So God, what is it that you want? And I hope sometimes he'll say left or right. But what if instead he just begins to form in you the appropriate heart? That's transformation. God changes our desires to be his. So we move beyond doing what we are supposed to do for God to doing what God desires to do. That's what we shift to. And guys, think about it. Like, do you really want a relationship with God that's just like taking orders? Jesus talks about this in one of his parables, Luke 17. This is what he says. Suppose one of you has a servant plowing or looking after the sheep. Will he say to that servant when he comes in from the field, "Come along now and sit down to eat"? Won't he rather say, "Prepare my supper, get yourself ready, and wait on me while I eat and drink. After that, you may eat and drink"? Will he thank the servant because he did what he was told to do? So you also, when you have done everything you were told to do, should say, "We are unworthy servants. We have only done our duty." Now, think about this. Underline that last line if you need to. But what Jesus is pointing out here is this. He's like, okay, great. So you've done everything you're supposed to do. You've got your orders. You've taken your orders. And he compares that image of your relationship with God to one of us who's a servant. And actually, the language here is more accurately slave. And I'm not saying it's bad to be that with God. I'm saying that Jesus here is pointing us to something better than that. Better than when you've done everything you were told to do, We are unworthy servants. We have only done our duty. Jesus is inviting us to go beyond doing what you were commanded, which is what a slave or servant would do. He's inviting us to move from mere obedience to loving union, not checking boxes, but out of love, instead, obedience naturally flows. Out of mere obedience, faith is stifled. Doubt and disappointment set in. The boundary diminishes, limits. The letter kills. We are not to reduce God to someone who tells us what to do, because it's an insufficient image of God. It is a image of God, a part of God, but it's not all of God. And I know, sometimes there's moments where it's like, man, if he would just be clear, if he would just say, if he would just speak up. But the reality is, if you think about that, if all we're interested in is hearing what he would do, or him telling us what he would do, we're not actually listening. We're not actually conversing. We're just taking orders. And I don't know about you, but like as a parent, and maybe if you're you're not a parent, but you've been in a place of management, there's a distinction between a relationship where you tell someone what to do and where you do something with them. There are moments, and I'm not saying this is all bad, where I tell my kids what to do, and I expect that they would follow everything I've commanded just the way I've put it. And I'll sit there and I'll observe, okay, so now I want you to do this. Oh, hold on. Start over. That's not what I said. You weren't listening to me. What did I say? Right? You can hear the dad's voice in me. Emerson, what did I say? Okay, so show me that you can do that. Blythe, what did I say? But it shifts when I move from simply telling them what to do to saying, let's do that together. And when I move the conversation, the relational dynamic from I'm the boss and you're the child, which is true, to let's do this together, the conversation, the dynamic shifts totally. The prayer life, the language, all of it begins to unfold uniquely. And we begin to say, man, that was awesome. See how that worked there? And we can celebrate that dynamic. Wow, you get it. That was fun. Look what we've done. The same thing is accomplished, but it feels extremely different. So when we pray, thy will be done, we are not asking for God to just reveal to us his will. We are saying in our prayer that I want to live where you live. I want to be as you are. That's totally different than just taking orders. Imagine when your prayers move from what do you want, God, to God, I know what you want. I know what's next. It's a shift. This is the blessedness of the pure in heart, right? Matthew 5:8, blessed are the pure in heart. They get it. They see God. They see beyond the boundary. There's more. This is the goodness David spoke of in Psalm 23. Surely your goodness and love will follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. There's a with principle here. There's a relational dynamic here that goes far beyond a task management. The blessedness of John 20, 29. Jesus said to him, "Have you believed because you have seen me? Blessed are those that have not seen and yet have believed." You see, there's a blessing in going without the senses, because the eyes can't see us through all the way. And this is a key sticky place for people, because we are overwhelmed with the visible world at every corner and every turn. But at every corner and every turn is also the fullness of the kingdom. And we get stuck trying to figure out where exactly are we between that. And we think to ourselves, well, maybe I just shouldn't pray because it can't be proven, or maybe there's nothing here at all. And we shrink back down. And we think, man, if God would just show up in the physical and, you know, shake us around. If only there was a sign. We want the physical to lead the way. But God refuses to be reduced to an idol. He refuses to come under the created. Dallas Willard says it this way, kind of uniquely. He says, "Few people arise in the morning as hungry for God as they are for cornflakes." We tend to live only into whatever's right in front of us. But in Lent, we need to realize that there's far more at stake, far more before us than what our eyes can see, our ears can hear, our hands can touch, our noses can smell, and our tongues can taste. "You shall not make for yourself a carved image or any likeness of anything that is in heaven above, or that is in the earth beneath, or that is in the water underneath the earth." See, God refuses to be reduced into the physical space, because in that place, you become the taskmaster. God would far rather teach us to have eyes to see. And that's not just talking about the physical. The senses can't measure God. So when you pray, you hold up a relational priority by removing the temptation to have it your way, to have it physical only. Which is why seeking the Spirit is life and peace, according to Paul. I'll end with this. In Romans 8, 6, we see it. The mind governed by the flesh is death, but the mind governed by the Spirit is life and peace. The burning desire that is in you to experience the reality of God is something you need to respond to. Chase after it. And every time you do, you are participating in a communion with God. And it's in that place that God will help remove you from the vices of the world and empower you to live fully in the kingdom. So Jesus, help us to pray. Help our desires to become your desires. Help us to experience the fullness of you here and now. Thank you, Christ, for my brothers and sisters. Lord, you know our wants. You know our needs. But thank you for still letting us bring it to you just the way it is. And as we share it with you, God, might you help us to increasingly notice and appreciate and wonder the things that you notice, appreciate, and wonder too. So that we might live not foolishly in the physical world alone, but in the total awareness of your presence and your kingdom, which is all around us. Amen.
Amen. I invite us to stand and respond to worship. Just to allow our hearts to burn for more of God. We sing this together. Also, just know that there's prayer available. If you need prayer for any reason at all, maybe you don't even have the words for it, but our prayer team would love to receive you in prayer in the prayer corner.
I want more of you, God. I want
control. I want more of you, God. 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 Just give us more, Jesus. Give us a passion. Passion for your name.
If you call yourself a human being, I hope you do, we are all made for perfect unity, integration, relationship. That's what it means to be fully human. That's what it meant to be human in the Garden of Eden. They were in perfect unity, integration, and relationship with God and with each other and within themselves. But then in Genesis 3, something happened and that got broken. And Christ, his life, his death, and his resurrection came and it made reparations. It fixed that. It's like he took dynamite to the wall of concrete. But the thing is, there's still like some rubble. There's still clutter in the way when we try to interact sometimes with God, when we try to see one another in relationship clearly, and when we try to connect with ourselves. A lot of times, as we notice during Lent, what our senses are doing and choosing seems to be very different sometimes than what our inner self would be choosing and doing. So right now we're going to go into a time of communion, but here's something that's just really cool about communion. He said, whenever you partake of this meal, of to remember him, to remember Christ and his love and what he did. The act of remembering something is something that our inner self, our spirit does. But the communion is something that our senses do. It's when we're eating. And right there in the act of communion, he is making all things new. He's bridging the gap between our spirit and our senses. And we do it every week because he asked us to. This is the table, not of the church, but of the Lord. It is to be made ready for those who love him and for those who want to love him more. So come, you who have much faith and you who have little. You who have been here often, and you who have not been here long. You who have tried to follow, and you who have failed. Come, because it is the Lord who invites you. It is his will that those who want him should meet him here. The way we take communion at Axiom, we have these aisles here, the center aisles. You can head to the tables on the side where there's like crackers and you can dip it. And then you can go and exit out the outside aisles. And we encourage you to gather in groups of two, three, four, and remember that Christ is in the midst with you. And, you know, don't block the flow of traffic when you do so. Thanks.
I'd rather be. no place I would rather be. Here in your love, here in your
We want to thank you so much for being here and worshiping with us today. It's been a real joy to be with you all here in this room. Just a reminder, for those of you who are new, this is maybe your first time here, or you've been coming here for a few weeks and you're like, okay, now I kind of want to learn a little bit more about what this Axiom place is. We got connect cards scattered around the room, or you can fill out a digital one at some of the kiosks in the back, but we want to make sure that we connect with you, that we get to know you. And so make sure you check the box on those cards to say, hey, I want somebody to take me out to coffee, because we want to take you out to coffee, and we want to get to hear your story. And here at Axiom, you'll hear us talk a lot about the importance of community and relationship. Well, this is the first step. We want to connect with you. We want to start building that relationship. We want to let you be part of this community in a deep and intimate way. And so please go ahead and fill out that Connect card. Check that box that says, I want to grab coffee. And yeah, just drop it off with one of our welcome folks or one of our hospitality people, or bring it to myself. I'd love to meet you. So thank you, guys. Will you stand with me now as I deliver our closing benediction? This comes from the Epistle of Jude, and Jude was one of Jesus' little brothers, and he writes this letter, and he concludes as he is writing it. So this is verse 24 we start. Now to him who is able to protect you from stumbling and to make you stand in the presence of his glory, blameless and with great joy, to the only God, our Savior, through Jesus Christ our Lord, be the glory, majesty, power, and authority before all time, now and forever. Amen. Go into your week and be blessed, friends.